Assalamu alaikum everyone, hope you all are doing good. Do subscribe the channel. The topic that we are going to discuss today is an important artifact of software design. So let's begin. Today we are going to discuss the class diagram. The UML class diagram is a graphical notation that is used to construct and visualize object-oriented systems. A class diagram in the Unified Modeling Language, aka UML, is a type of static structure diagram that describes the structure of a system by showing the system's classes, their attributes, operations, or in other words, the methods, and the relationship among the objects, or in other words, the relationship among the classes. The classes are shown as a rectangle with the name of the class centered in the rectangle, like this. Class name should start with a capital letter and have no spaces between multiple words. However, each word should start with a capital letter. Each class symbol may also include compartments for attributes, operations, or it may have no compartment at all, like shown here. The student. A list of compartment is an area containing a list of whichever class feature is contained by that particular compartment. It could either be the attributes or the operations or the class name. Attributes and operations are referred to collectively as features of the class. The different notations of the class that are acceptable are the class name only, the class name with a list of attributes, the class name and the list of operations, or class name with both list of attributes and the list of operations. The two other common compartments or components of a class are the attributes and the operations list. Each attribute and operation are listed one per line in their respective compartment. Each attribute and operation name should start with a lowercase letter. The only exception to this is a constructor operation of a class, which will have the same name as the class itself. That is, it will start from the capital letter and will have no spaces in between. However, each word will start from a capital letter. Attribute and operations name, on the other hand, should have no spaces between them, but they will start from a lowercase letter. But each middle word of the attributes or the operation should start with a capital letter, such as take lectures. The lectures is starting from the capital L. Give exams. The exam E is starting from the capital E. Attributes and operations can be assigned a level of visibility on the class diagram. A visibility indicator in the figure is shown, like minus and plus. The visibility of a feature can be defined by either a keyword or a symbol. So there are three specific types of visibility: the private, the public, and the protected. There is no default visibility value. So that means we have to explicitly mention the visibility of each attribute and operation. So here, the private visibility means that a feature is available only within the class that owns that particular feature. Public visibility means that a feature is available to any class associated with the particular class that owns that feature. So that means the name, age, registration, and date of birth are only accessible for this particular student class, whereas the take lectures, give exams, which have the public visibility, are accessible to any class that is going to be associated with this particular student class. On the other hand, the protected visibility means that a feature is available within the class that owns that particular feature, and any subtype of that class may have access to this particular feature. Attributes can have three different type of properties. Number one is the initial attribute values. The initial value attribute is an attribute property in which an attribute is set with an initial value. The initial value for an attribute can be specified as part of the class diagram by including the clause equals and giving the initial value after the attribute type. So in here, the date registered have a type of date and its default value is the current date. The second is the derived attribute. The derived attribute is an attribute property in which the value of an attribute can be measured from the value of other attributes. So here, age is a derived attribute because its value can be calculated from the date of today and the date of birth right here. The third one is multiplicity. A multiplicity clause can be used to indicate the number of separate values that an attribute can hold. The multiplicity of an attribute takes the form of a multiplicity clause, which consists of a lower and upper bound range enclosed in a square brackets. Here, the attribute middle name has the multiplicity property. According to this multiplicity property, the middle name attribute can either have zero middle name or two middle names. The lower bound of the multiplicity, represented by m, and here it's zero, can be any non-negative integer greater than or equals to the zero. And similarly, the upper bound n, which is 2 in this case, can be any integer which is greater or equals to the m. The name, parameter, list, and return type of an operation are collectively known as its signature. It is very much possible to have several operations with the same name and return type in one class, provided that those operations each has a different parameter list to the other same name operations, just like the overloading. The ability to specify the signature of an operation without specifying its method is a useful feature in object-oriented modeling. Knowing the operation signature provides a clear specification for the collaboration between the operations. So let's see the example. So here is an example of a power operation in a class calculator. So the operation visibility is public, its return type is integer, and it's taking a number as a parameter, which is integer. And here I have specified all of those. The operation parameters can be represented in class diagram using provided notations. Each parameter will have a parameter name and its type. For example, the factorial and its parameter is num and its type is integer. We can omit the parameter name and only write the parameter type as well. So for example, factorial and integer only, we have not mentioned the parameter name. The default value of the parameter can be specified as well. For example, right here, factorial num is of type integer and its default value is 5. The specification of a method body for an operation may be included as a note attached to an operation of the class diagram. This would be done normally where the specification for a method is relatively small. So for example, here I have a calculator class whose operation is power and I have added the specification with a note. The class properties are listed in curly braces. So the properties can be isLeaf, isRoot, or isAbstract. isLeaf can be used to specify whether or not a class can be subtyped through a generalization structure. isRoot property can be used to specify whether or not the class may be a specialization of another class. isAbstract property can be used to specify whether or not the class will be abstract. So, association. An object-oriented system is built from class types that collaborate with each other by passing messages and receiving different responses. So, when instance of one class pass messages to the instance of the other class, an association is implied between these two classes. So UML shows an association between these two classes with a solid line like this. The association can be labeled with the name to indicate the nature of the association. Right here, it teaches. If an association is labeled with an arrow, and the arrowhead should be used to with the association name to indicate the direction in which the text of the association name should be interpreted. So for example, in this particular case, we will read it as teacher teaches students and not student teaches teacher. So the association between the teacher and student classes has been shown right here and will be read as teacher teaches student. In term of an association, multiplicity indicates the number of object instances of the class at one end of an association for one instance of the class at the other end of the association. The multiplicity can be seen in the figure with one to many and one to many. Here it indicates that minimum of one teacher and minimum of one student will be part of the association between these two classes, and maximum of as many teachers as they can or as many teachers as possible will be a part of the association between these two classes. Relationship between two classes. The association between classes can be of the following types. It could be aggregation, it could be composition, or it could be the generalization. Let's see a brief examples of all. Aggregation. An aggregation association is used to indicate that as well as having attributes of its own, an instance of one class may consist of or include instances of another class. Aggregation is also known as whole part association. So let me explain it some further. So instances of the class at one end of the association represents the whole entity is made up of parts of the class on the other end of the association. So UMS uses an unfilled diamond like this at the end of the association to denote an aggregation relationship. The aggregation diamond is always at the whole end of the association. So that means assembly is the class that is whole and component is the class that is part. Assembly class is whole as we have established that because it has a diamond towards it, and component is a part. So let's take another example to understand this more. So another example of the aggregation relationship could be a car and its component, such as engine, tires, seats, and wheels, etc. The point to remember here, the whole part relationship is not strict, which means the parts can exist even without the whole. So that means engine, tires, seats, or wheels may exist without existing the cars. The composition. Like an aggregation association, composition association also implies a whole part structure between two classes. The coincident lifetime means that when the whole end of the association is created, then the part components are also created. So that means when a document is created, the section and index will be created as well. And when the whole is deleted, so when the document is deleted, the parts will be deleted as well. So when the document is deleted, the section and index will be deleted as well. However, it also implies that the lifetime of both whole and part will be same. In other words, in composition, a part class cannot exist without the whole part, which is the basic difference between the aggregation and composition. The major difference between the composition and aggregation will be stated as that in the aggregation, the parts may exist without the whole class, but in composition, the part cannot be existed without the whole. Generalization. Generalization is a different type of association relationship. It is sometimes described as being a kind of relationship. Generalization is shown in UML as a line ending with a triangular arrowhead at the class which is the more general type. So laptop is kind of computer, desktop is kind of computer. So this is the generalization relationship between computer, laptop, and desktop classes. Object instances. Class diagram provide notations to show the objects or instances of the class as well. So normally the objects or instances are used to illustrate the object diagram of the system for a particular scenario. However, if necessary, we can have objects in the class diagram as well, but it's not recommended. The method to have a particular object in the class diagram is as follows. So, the basic object notation is very similar to the class notation. The name compartment of the object shows the name of the object, instance, and its class type. The name of the object is the form of instance name, and then the class name, and we have it all underlined. And then this is how we are going to represent it. Let's see an example. So here I have an example to show the object diagram constructed from the class diagram. So I have class diagram, writer and document, and the object diagram has been constructed from these. The notation to represent an object is same as the class, that is a rectangle. However, the object class name is underlined like John and writer. So that means John is an object of the writer class, and it contains the values of the attributes of the class. So John, the name is Jones and the age is 35. And similarly, the John have two documents, and the first document is draft and the second one is master. The name is legal and the page number 54, and second the page number is 32. Here we have an example of a class diagram for an ATM bank account with several different relationships that could be seen in the diagram. That's all about the class diagrams. So hope this lecture has helped you to understand the class diagram, its importance, its notations and components. If you have any queries or topic requests, feel free to comment them. Do subscribe, like and follow the channel. Allah Hafiz everyone.